Chew on this, your way. On April 9, 2003, a U.S. Marine armored vehicle pulled down the gigantic statue of Saddam Hussein in central Baghdad, showing the world that the United States had finally driven him from power. 9 weeks later, the first Burger King opened in Iraq. American soldiers waited as long as 2 hours to buy Whoppers and Chicken Royales at the new restaurant located in Baghdad International Airport. Pizza Huts, Burger Kings, and Subways soon opened at U.S. military bases throughout Iraq. Running a Burger King in the middle of a war zone presented all sorts of unusual challenges. Hamburger buns, ground beef, chicken, and french fries had to be airlifted into the country and then carried by trucks along dangerous roads. Joe Petrusich, a Canadian businessman employed by a Kuwaiti company to operate many of the restaurants for the U.S. Department of Defense, had to fly from one restaurant to another in Black Hawk helicopters to make sure everything was done properly. "It is very, very challenging," Petrusich told a reporter. "You're dealing with problems every day. I get phone calls saying bridges have been blown up and we can't get our trucks through." Not long after the restaurant at the Baghdad airport opened, it became one of the most successful Burger Kings in the world, selling more than 5,000 sandwiches a day. The opening of Pizza Huts and Burger Kings in war-torn Iraq shows how badly the fast food chains want to expand overseas. As competition has become fiercer in the United States, fast food companies have looked to foreign markets as the source of future growth. In 1991, McDonald's had fewer than 4,000 restaurants outside the United States. Today, it has about 18,000 restaurants in 120 foreign countries. Classes at McDonald's Hamburger University in Oak Brook, Illinois, are now taught in 20 different languages. McDonald's now earns the majority of its profits outside the United States, as does KFC. The values, tastes, and marketing practices of the American fast food industry are being exported to every corner of the globe. In the same way that American cities are beginning to look similar, filled with identical chain restaurants and stores, many foreign cities are beginning to look a lot like each other. They are becoming Americanized. This international spread of uniformity and conformity, according to political scientist Benjamin R. Barber, is creating a McWorld. People in poor and developing nations often view McDonald's and the other fast food chains as symbols of American freedom, progress, and technology. They can't wait for fast food joints to open nearby. In 1990, when McDonald's opened its first Moscow restaurant, 500 Russians patiently stood in line to eat there. In 1994, when a McDonald's opened in Kuwait, the line of cars waiting for the drive-through window extended for 7 miles. Around the same time, a KFC restaurant in Saudi Arabia's holy city of Mecca set a new sales record for the chain, earning $200,000 in a single week. Few places on earth now seem too distant or too remote for Colonel Sanders or the Golden Arches. Much like the cigarette companies, which started to target people in poor and developing countries when Americans cut back on smoking, soda companies are now trying to expand their sales overseas. They are not only opening bottling plants in poor countries, they are also supplying stores with refrigerators and providing electricity to run these fridges. Driven by the belief that a bottle cold is a bottle sold, soda companies have given away hundreds of thousands of refrigerators to stores in Africa. The soda industry is trying to increase its throat share overseas, making sure that whenever people are thirsty, they drink soda. In 1998, Coca-Cola's partner in Latin America launched a marketing scheme called the 100 Meters Program. The objective of this program is simple. Panamco, Coke's business partner, said, "In any urban center, no one should have to walk more than 100 meters, about 300 feet, to buy our product. It aimed to put Coke products everywhere, at all times of the day. In addition to supplying supermarkets and fast food restaurants, Panamco planned to sell soda at schools, factories, office buildings, newsstands, beauty salons, and drugstores. It hired street vendors to sell Cokes at traffic lights in Venezuela and even put coolers in Colombian taxi cabs." Storming KFC. America's fast food companies have become so big and so powerful worldwide that it may seem like nothing can stop them. But their rapid expansion overseas, which looks so impressive on a map, may actually be a sign of their growing weakness in America. One of the reasons McDonald's started to open so many restaurants overseas is that it was running out of places to open them in America. All the good locations seem to be taken, and new customers will have to be found elsewhere. As the fast food industry grows more dependent on foreign sales, it faces new and unexpected risks. When people overseas love the United States, they're eager to buy American products and shop at American stores. But when anti-American feelings rise, the anger is often directed at U.S. companies that sell hamburgers, sodas, and fries. "Resist America, beginning with cola," said a banner at Beijing University in May 1999. "Attack McDonald's, storm KFC." The U.S. Air Force had just accidentally bombed the Chinese embassy in Belgrade, Yugoslavia, and anti-American demonstrations were erupting throughout China. At least a dozen McDonald's and four KFC restaurants were damaged by Chinese protesters. For some reason, no Pizza Huts were harmed. "Maybe they think it's Italian," said a Pizza Hut spokesman in Shanghai. A generation ago, American embassies and oil companies were the most likely targets of overseas demonstrations against the United States. Today, fast food restaurants have assumed that role, with McDonald's a particular favorite. In 1995, a crowd of 400 Danish protesters looted a McDonald's in downtown Copenhagen, made a bonfire of its furniture in the street, and burned the restaurant to the ground. In 1998, bombs destroyed a McDonald's in St. Petersburg, Russia, two McDonald's near Athens, Greece, a McDonald's in the heart of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and a Planet Hollywood in Cape Town, South Africa. In 1999, Belgian vegetarians set fire to a McDonald's in Antwerp, and a year later, protesters tore the sign off of McDonald's in London's Trafalgar Square, destroyed the restaurant, and handed out free hamburgers to the crowd. A few months later, a French farmer named José Bové demolished a McDonald's under construction in his hometown of Millau. Angry about the devastating impact of cheap, industrialized American food, Bové later wrote a best-selling book entitled "The World Is Not for Sale, and Nor Am I." The war in Afghanistan and the invasion of Iraq prompted a series of new fast food attacks. In 2002, three people were killed by a bomb blast at a McDonald's in Indonesia. McDonald's restaurants were destroyed in Russia, Ecuador, Saudi Arabia, and Lebanon, and Burger King restaurants were attacked in Egypt, Qatar, Oman, Bahrain, and Lebanon. Over the next few years, a McDonald's in Turkey was bombed, a protester blew himself up outside a McDonald's in northern Italy, and two firebombs were discovered outside a McDonald's in Rome. KFC restaurants in Saudi Arabia and Bahrain were attacked, and one KFC restaurant in Karachi, Pakistan was destroyed twice. After being rebuilt after the first attack, it was burned to the ground in May 2005, killing six KFC workers inside. So many fast food restaurants have now been bombed overseas that the major chains are installing shatterproof windows, special ceiling tiles that can absorb bomb shrapnel, and large outdoor containers made of cement and planted with flowers to protect against car bombs. The violence directed at McDonald's and KFC is the most dramatic sign of the fast food industry's problem overseas. Even more serious, however, is the way in which popular attitudes toward food are beginning to change, especially in Europe and Japan, two of the industry's largest markets. European and Japanese consumers want to know where their food comes from and how it's made. The spread of a deadly, mysterious disease played a large role in opening their eyes. During the 1980s, cattle in Great Britain started to act strangely, became ill, and then died. A new disease, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, nicknamed BSE, or mad cow disease, was literally destroying their brains. British scientists linked mad cow disease to an unlikely ingredient that some agribusiness companies were quietly putting into cattle feed, dead cows. The leftover meat and blood from slaughterhouses was being fed to cattle as a cheap form of protein. The news disgusted British consumers. They were outraged that cattle were being turned into cannibals and afraid that mad cow disease might spread to human beings. For years, the British government assured the public that the disease couldn't harm people who ate beef. And then, in March 1996, the British Health Secretary announced that eating meat from cattle with mad cow disease did indeed pose a risk to people. It could cause an incurable illness, a human form of mad cow disease that destroyed a person's brain. Throughout Europe and Japan, governments had promised for years that beef was perfectly safe to eat. That proved to be a lie. Soon, millions of cattle potentially infected with mad cow disease had to be removed from farms, slaughtered, and then burned. So many needed to be killed that in Denmark, a company built a power plant to generate electricity by burning cattle. The sale of beef plummeted, and consumers in Europe and Japan began to demand tough food safety rules. And the sale of organic foods, produced naturally without growth hormones, antibiotics, or pesticides, skyrocketed. Amazed that companies would feed dead cattle to other cattle just to save money, consumers demanded a return to traditional forms of agriculture. The German government took the lead, declaring that 1/5 of the country's farmland would be organic by the year 2010. Germany also became the first country in the European Union to add language guaranteeing animal rights to its constitution, and its Minister for Agriculture declared that cattle would no longer be given feed that could harm them. Our cows, she said, should get only water, grain, and grass. The New Ronald. Facing criticism overseas and in the United States, McDonald's has worked hard in recent years to improve its public image. In 2001, the company responded to American fears about mad cow disease by imposing strict rules on its beef suppliers. The Food and Drug Administration, FDA, the U.S. government agency responsible for the safety of animal feed, had already banned the practice of feeding dead cattle to cattle. But the FDA hadn't done much to ensure that feed companies were obeying the rules. As panic about mad cow disease spread throughout Europe and hamburger sales there plummeted, McDonald's told the leading U.S. meatpacking companies that they would have to keep dead cattle out of their cattle feed and make sure that the FDA's rules were being followed, or McDonald's wouldn't buy any more of their beef. Meatpacking companies that routinely fought tooth and nail against any new government regulations quickly agreed to do exactly what McDonald's wanted. The fast food chain was their largest customer. "Because we have the world's biggest shopping cart," a McDonald's spokesman explained, "we can use that leadership to provide more focus and more order throughout the beef system." In 2001, McDonald's also instructed its meat suppliers to do a better job of treating animals humanely. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, PETA, was threatening nationwide protests against the chain, and McDonald's decided to use its power over the meatpacking industry to eliminate some of the most obvious abuses of factory farms. McDonald's told its egg suppliers that hens should have enough room to stand in their cages. Previously, the hens were crammed so tightly together that they often couldn't stand on their own feet. The egg suppliers agreed to McDonald's request. After all, McDonald's was the nation's largest purchaser of eggs. The hens got a little more space, about 72 square inches for each bird, roughly the size of a piece of computer paper. That was better, but still not enough room for the hens to walk around. McDonald's also told its chicken, pork, and beef suppliers to minimize the amount of suffering that animals endured at their slaughterhouses. Other fast food chains soon followed McDonald's animal welfare policies. None of them, however, has insisted on strict new rules to protect the human beings in meatpacking plants, the workers being injured on the job every day. Over the past few years, McDonald's and other fast food chains have added healthier items to their menus. The new marketing campaigns about healthy eating may reflect a sincere concern for the well-being of their customers. Or they may simply be a public relations effort to avoid blame for America's obesity epidemic. In 2005, McDonald's became the largest purchaser of apples in the United States, and it now sells more salads than any other company. Healthier options, unfortunately, don't always lead to healthier eating. The Washington Post estimated that almost 98% of McDonald's customers don't order a salad. "The most popular item on our menu," a McDonald's spokesman admitted to the newspaper, "continues to be the double cheeseburger, hands down. The most successful new item on the Burger King menu isn't the veggie burger. It's the enormous omelet breakfast sandwich, which contains more calories, 740, and more grams of fat, 46, than a Whopper." The fast food industry would like people to believe the problem isn't the food, it's the customer's behavior. "There are no good foods or bad foods," the industry argues, implying that if you're overweight, it's your own fault. The emphasis is on changing what the customers do, not what the fast food companies do. With that goal in mind, Ronald McDonald has undergone a makeover. Instead of being a silly clown who plays only with small children, Ronald has become a snowboarding, skateboarding hipster who wants to influence preteens. McDonald's hopes he will serve as a global ambassador for fun, fitness, and children's well-being. The actors who visit restaurants dressed as Ronald McDonald have been told to exercise and get into shape, or they'll be fired. Despite all the talk about healthy eating, McDonald's has not yet offered to pay hip-hop artists millions of dollars to sing about eating fresh fruits and vegetables. A recent marketing campaign for the Big Mac, aimed at young teens, ignores the whole idea of healthy eating and focuses instead on a subject that really has nothing to do with hamburgers: sex. Ray Kroc, who tried to keep flirting teenagers out of his restaurants, might not have appreciated the sexual overtones for the latest slogans advertising Big Macs. "Bite me like it's your first time" is one. "My buns demand both hands" is another. Kids with knives. As a child in the 1950s, Alice Waters was a picky eater. She didn't like foods with thick sauces. She didn't like stews, creamy spinach, or overcooked meat. She liked simple things, like the fruits and vegetables her father grew in the backyard garden of their little house in Chatham, New Jersey. Her family didn't have a lot of money, so they didn't go to restaurants frequently. They ate meals at the dining room table. Alice didn't like the food at school, and in those days kids were allowed to eat in the cafeteria or go home for lunch. Most days Alice went home. She was picky, but still enjoyed eating certain junk foods every now and then. Potato chips, orange soda, jelly donuts, chili cheeseburgers. Alice moved to Berkeley, California for college. The University of California at Berkeley was known for its radical thinking, for students who liked to make waves and challenge conventional wisdom. During the 1960s, Berkeley students campaigned for racial equality, for women's rights, for an end to the war in Vietnam. Alice fit in well at Berkeley. There was nothing ordinary about her. At the age of 19, she took a year off and lived in France. The experience changed her forever. She fell in love with the food there. She felt like she'd never eaten before. The people she met in France cared intensely about food, about how it was bought and sold and prepared and served at the table. Meals were more than a way to fill your belly. They were a way to enjoy conversation, family, and friendship. They weren't something rushed and soon forgotten. They were meant to bring people together. Alice returned home determined to learn how to cook. She wanted to introduce the United States to a whole new outlook on food. She studied French cookbooks and started making meals for friends, and then in 1971 she opened a restaurant in Berkeley and gave it a French name, Chez Panisse. At the restaurant she offered food that was simple and fresh, food that mainly got the taste not from fancy sauces and seasonings, but from the quality of the basic ingredients. Alice always sought out the best tasting tomatoes, the best peaches, the best plums. When she couldn't buy them at the market, she found people to grow them for her. She formed close ties with local farmers and ranchers, refusing to buy food that was out of season or that had been transported thousands of miles. The food she bought had to be organic, locally produced, and delicious. Chez Panisse was soon considered one of the finest restaurants in the United States, and Alice Waters was hailed as one of the nation's greatest chefs. She was a true radical, not the kind who wants to destroy things or tear them down, but the kind who looks past the surface to the fundamental nature of things. During the same years that fast food chains were turning restaurant kitchens into little factories and livestock into industrial commodities, Alice championed an old-fashioned view of food. It stood for a different set of American values: honesty, integrity, wholesomeness, and most of all, community. Every day while driving to Chez Panisse in the morning and driving home late at night, Alice passed Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School. It seemed like a sad place with graffiti on the windows and burned-out grass on the lawn. Although students still attended classes there, the school looked neglected. Alice wondered how the people of Berkeley, who considered themselves so high-minded and aware, could allow a public school to fall apart this way. She made this point during a newspaper interview and not long afterward got a call from Neil Smith, the school's principal. He invited her to Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School and asked her to help beautify the place. During a visit to the school, Alice became less concerned about how the place looked and much more concerned about what the kids were being fed there. Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School had been built in the 1920s to educate 500 children. Now it had about twice that many students. The cafeteria was too small to feed so many kids. It had been shut down for years and was being used to store old tables and chairs. There was still nasty old leftover food in the ovens. Lunch was served at a snack bar on the edge of the playground. Alice watched kids standing around eating reheated frozen hamburgers, chicken nuggets, and fries. She was appalled. The sight of the abandoned cafeteria and the cheap fast food made her realize that something had to be done right away to change the way these kids thought about food, and she decided to do it. 12 years after Alice's first visit to Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School, it has the most innovative and remarkable food program in the United States. Called the Edible Schoolyard, it doesn't just provide healthy, nutritious meals. It gives kids a first-hand education in the role that food plays in society. It teaches skills they can use for the rest of their lives. After raising money through her Chez Panisse Foundation, Alice supervised the planting of an enormous garden at Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School. An acre of asphalt was torn up, topsoil was hauled in, and all sorts of plants, flowers, fruit trees, and vines were planted. Today, the school garden produces strawberries, potatoes, tomatoes, lettuce, herbs, beans, corn, pumpkins, asparagus, broccoli, beets, carrots, garlic, cucumbers, peppers, cabbage, and Brussels sprouts, among other things. There's a chicken coop where hens can wander freely and lay eggs. There's a wood-burning outdoor oven for cooking pizza and baking bread. The place looks like a small farm in the heart of a lovely town. The 6th, 7th, and 8th graders at Martin Luther King Jr. come from a wide variety of backgrounds. About 20 different languages are spoken at students' homes. Roughly one-third of the kids are African-American, one-third are white, and the rest are mainly Asian or Latino. All of them have to work in the garden, planting, tending, and harvesting food. And all of them have to work in the school's new kitchen, learning how to prepare food, how to serve it, and how to clean up after everybody's eaten it. Esther Cook, the chef teacher at the Edible Schoolyard, has thought up many ingenious ways to combine cooking and gardening with learning. In the classroom, food-related subjects are used to help teach science, history, and ecology. A science project might involve earthworms in the garden. A history project might unfold in the kitchen, with samples of what European serfs ate during the Middle Ages. Teachers work with their students in the garden and the kitchen. At Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School, food isn't something you scarf down quickly and then forget about. It's an integral part of daily life. On a recent day in the kitchen, 32 sixth graders got ready to make a simple fruit salad. They were new to the school. They washed their hands, put on green aprons, and grabbed sharp knives. Esther Cook told them to keep the knives at their sides, pointed downward. She didn't want anyone to get stabbed. The kids sat at three big tables. A few seemed afraid of the knives. "You guys can handle it," Esther said. "They're not toys, but you can handle it." The kids started peeling, slicing, and dicing the fruit. Large steel tubs were soon filled with pieces of kiwi, orange, and pepino dulce, a pear-shaped fruit with greenish flesh that tastes like honeydew melon or cantaloupe. Napkins and plaid tablecloths were brought out, the tables were set, the food was served, and everyone started to eat. For some students, long accustomed to eating microwave dinners in front of the TV, those school meals were the first ones they'd ever made from scratch. The Edible Schoolyard has proven to be a tremendous success. Other schools throughout the United States have sent teachers to study it and then planted their own gardens. In 2004, the Shea Panisse Foundation agreed to help the Berkeley Unified School District change the food that is served in every one of its schools. Alice is now supervising the creation of new gardens and new kitchens, finding new suppliers of organic food, figuring out how to prepare healthy meals for 9,000 students every day, and privately raising the money to do all of those things. It is a mammoth undertaking. While other famous chefs are opening chain restaurants and putting their names on frozen meals, Alice is trying to protect the environment, support independent farmers, and change the way American children think about food. Her work demonstrates the importance of learning from the past. Sometimes new ideas aren't really that new. More than a century ago, a California educator argued that every school in the United States should have a garden. These gardens, he said, will teach children that actions have consequences, that private citizens should take care of public property, and that labor has dignity, that nature is beautiful. Changing the world. The U.S. Congress should ban advertising that exploits children. It should prevent soda companies and fast food companies from marketing unhealthy foods in schools. It should pass tough food safety laws. It should raise the minimum wage. It should pass tougher work safety laws. It should punish companies that mistreat animals. It should ensure that independent farmers and ranchers have a free and fair market for their products. It should fight against dangerous concentrations of corporate power. It should promote the kind of agriculture and the kind of eating habits that are sustainable. Congress should do all those things, but it isn't likely to do any of them soon. The political power of the fast food companies and their big suppliers makes a discussion of what Congress should do largely meaningless. The fast food industry spends millions of dollars every year trying to influence politicians and billions more trying to influence people through advertising. The wealth and power of the major chains makes them seem invincible, and yet these corporations must obey the demands of a group that's even more powerful, a group whom they desperately want to attract and please, consumers. Nobody is forced to buy fast food. The first step toward real change is by far the easiest. Stop buying it. If you don't like the way fast food companies behave, don't give them any of your money. Every dollar that you spend on food is like a vote. When you buy something from a company, you are in effect voting for its policies and its behavior. Burger King, KFC, and McDonald's choose to do business one way, selling highly processed food, keeping wages low, seeking to make everything everywhere the same. Other companies have chosen a different path and still earn large profits. In 1948, the same year that the McDonald brothers introduced the Speedy Service System, Harry and Esther Snyder opened their first In-N-Out Burger restaurant on the road between Los Angeles and Palm Springs. It was America's first drive-through hamburger stand. Today, there are almost 200 In-N-Outs in California and Nevada. Harry Snyder died in 1976, but at the age of 85, Esther still serves as president of the family-owned company. The Snyders have declined countless offers to sell the chain, refused to franchise it, and have succeeded by rejecting just about everything the rest of the fast food industry does. In-N-Out isn't your typical fast food chain. There are verses from the Bible on the bottom of its soda cups. More importantly, the chain pays the highest wages in the fast food industry. Full-time workers get a benefits package that includes medical, dental, vision, and life insurance. The typical In-N-Out restaurant manager has a salary about 3 times higher than that of managers at other fast food restaurants. The In-N-Out managers have, on average, been with the company for more than a decade. The high wages at In-N-Out haven't led to higher prices or lower quality food. The most expensive item on the menu costs $2.50. There are no microwaves, heat lamps, or fancy machinery in the kitchens at an In-N-Out restaurant. The ground beef is fresh, the potatoes are peeled every day to make French fries, and the milkshakes are made from real ice cream. Treating workers well and using fresh food instead of frozen makes a big difference. For the past 7 years in a row, a survey by Restaurants and Institutions magazine has found that among fast food hamburger chains, In-N-Out ranks first in food quality, value, service, atmosphere, and cleanliness. As a result, the company earns some of the highest profits per restaurant in the industry. Burgerville is another chain that proves that a fast food company can behave responsibly. Founded in 1961 by George Propstra, the chain now operates 39 restaurants in Oregon and Washington State. It's also a family-owned company, distinguished by a long-standing commitment to selling fresh, locally produced food. Most of Burgerville's ingredients are purchased from farmers and ranchers in the Pacific Northwest. Instead of transporting frozen food thousands of miles, the chain allows items to come and go from the menu, depending on the time of year. When local strawberries and huckleberries are in season, Burgerville uses them to make milkshakes. When the onions are ripe in Walla Walla, Washington, it uses them to make onion rings. The cheese for its cheeseburgers comes from Tillamook, Oregon. The beef comes from Oregon Country Beef, a group of ranching families that refuse to give their cattle growth hormones, antibiotics, genetically engineered grain, or feed that contains dead animals. In August 2005, Burgerville began to purchase renewable wind power for all the electricity at its restaurants. And instead of toys inspired by the latest Hollywood cartoons, the kids' meals at Burgerville often include packets of seeds and a gardening tool with which to plant them. In-N-Out and Burgerville aren't perfect, but they show that fast food companies can do well by doing good. Thousands of independent restaurants across the United States are guided by the same spirit. The executives who run the giant fast food chains aren't bad people. They are people who need to broaden their views and accept responsibility for their actions. They will pay higher wages if you demand it. They will treat workers and animals in the land differently if you insist on it. They want your money, your vote. 100 books could be written about the problems of the fast food industry. But the solution starts with you. Pull open the glass door, feel the rush of cool air, walk inside, get in line, and look around you. Look at the kids working in the kitchen, at the customers in their seats, at the ads for the latest toys. Study the backlit color photographs above the counter. Think about where the food came from, about how and where it was made, about what is set in motion by every single fast food purchase, the ripple effect near and far. Think about it. Then place your order. Or turn and walk out the door. It's not too late. Even in this fast food nation, you can still have it your way.